Hello and welcome to Strategic News International. I am Nitin Gokhale. 17 years ago today, a legendary guerrilla leader and a military genius, Ahmad Shah Massoud of Afghanistan, a Tajik leader but also a leader of many northern tribes in Afghanistan who also commanded respect in southern Afghanistan, was assassinated by two assassins posing as journalists. That was 2 days before 9/11 happened. Why it happened, how it happened is a matter of record already. But who was Ahmad Shah Massoud? What was his importance? And how did he rally around him so many young people in Afghanistan to take on what essentially was a Taliban militia backed by Pakistani army in Afghanistan? To tell us more about Ahmad Shah Massoud, we have with us Lieutenant General R.K. Sahani, retired, who was at that point in time India's Director General of Military Intelligence and the points person who was liaisoning with the Northern Alliance and more particularly personally with Ahmad Shah Massoud. He has very fond memories of Ahmad Shah Massoud, but there are many more insights that General Sahani can provide to us, and therefore we thought as a tribute to that military genius in Afghanistan, we must talk to someone who knew him intimately. General Sahani, thank you very much for your time. You in 2001 or even before, you were in touch with the Northern Alliance on behalf of the government. Of course, there were other people, but you were a key person. What are the memories that you have of Ahmad Shah Massoud?
I think, first of all, I must thank you that you have given me the opportunity to pay tribute to a person whom I regard not only as a good leader, as a great leader, but also a commander. And a commander who had hardly any resources, and despite the paucity of the resources, he held forth, a very honest man, a very dedicated man. Somehow or the other, with the limited resources, he created an environment. He made sure the fervor for the, independence of Afghanistan from the influences which were inimical to it, were sort of a continued. I have known this man. Mm-hmm. I came across him and I suddenly found that after some time, that he was an extraordinary personality. Actually, a very sophisticated person in his own way, who could only speak Dari and French. Mm-hmm. And whenever you conversed with him, you had to get it translated. But in his presence, you felt overawed. And somehow or the other, he reminded me of Netaji Subhash Bose. Mm-hmm. Because like him, this man had ventured on a quest without the resources, without money and without support, and held his own.
Sir.
As a matter of fact, this person, when he created an army, a militia of his own, he had very limited resources. Mm-hmm. He was being helped by the Iranians, who were very hard taskmasters, and in a way I thought were too tough with him. Mm-hmm. He had to bear them because ultimately he had no alternative.
Right.
Russians also did help, but Russians helped in a half-hearted way, and mm-hmm. we of course gave the material help in terms of money, etc.
Right.
But the resources were never enough.
Mm-hmm.
And he was fighting not the Taliban, mm-hmm. as people have a misconception.
Mm-hmm.
He was actually fighting with the Pakistan army, mm-hmm. who were masquerading as the, Taliban.
Mm-hmm.
And it was actually, to tell you the truth, a losing battle.
Mm-hmm.
Because gradually and slowly, whatever territory he held, he had to continue to, tactically, it kept on shrinking.
Mm-hmm.
But he held his own. At one particular time, I still recollect,
mm-hmm.
we almost despaired that probably he will now be completely run over. Mm-hmm. But he surprisingly showed so much of grit,
mm-hmm.
and inspired his people in such a fashion that they held on.
Right.
A very honest man, if you seriously ask mm-hmm. me, a very simple man.
Mm-hmm.
And he refused to leave Afghanistan.
Correct.
Most of the people who are his fighters who were fighting along with him, and Northern Alliance of course was an amalgamation
mm-hmm.
of all the ethnicities, predominantly the northern tribes like Tajiks, Uzbeks, Turkmanis,
mm-hmm.
and Uzbek, etc. But he also attracted the southern tribes like Pashtuns.
Yes.
There was a charismatic personality, the mm-hmm. idea of a independent Afghanistan was the one which he created, and he helped both.
Right. How did you come in touch with him, sir?
I actually, as a DGMI, of course, mm-hmm. they were a help out. We were supposed to be helping him out. Mm-hmm. And I met him, and he met also his associates. Mm-hmm. Person like Mr. Abdullah, who is now the
CEO of this thing,
he was his emissary.
Abdullah
was his emissary. He used to, and then of course his generals, general like Bismillah Khan, who ultimately rose to become the defense minister.
Right.
Kanuni. Mm-hmm. So what I was absolutely astonished was that with those limited resources, he created soldiers.
Right.
He created commanders. Mm-hmm. I was very fortunate that after retirement, that was unfortunately the time when he was no more, and I saw these commanders in action with rudimentary sort of a communication equipment. They were getting in touch with each other, but more to talk about this man itself.
Was he a military genius as is made out to
be? He was absolutely a military genius because at one particular time I remember. There was a meeting going on, and I won't name as to where the meeting was. And basically, in the meeting, one of the Iranians was trying to tell him to attack and force him to attack. And when the meeting ended, this chap kept quiet and he said that he'll give it a thought. I told that Iranian, I said to a general, to a commander, you only give resources. You don't give him the plan, because that is what the plan he sort of, what do you call, is supposed to make himself. You see, basically he was a genius in the sense that with very limited resources, he hardly had, by the time I'm talking about, he had been left only with about 12 or 13 tanks. Now the way he skillfully used them, the tanks were also not maintained because he didn't have the resources, the ammunition was limited. He used them very well. He had very, I think by the time this happened, he had been pushed, and I think he had very limited aircrafts, I think about three or four of the fighter planes.
Correct.
But again, very effectively. I mean, imagine I saw those machines, I saw those aircrafts, I saw the helicopters, and I saw the tanks. I don't think anybody else could have used them.
That's right.
But by the sheer personality, by force, by inspiring people, motivating them, he made use of those machineries and continued to do the battle. But he was all the time forced to withdraw back because there was no other option.
But it's interesting that you mentioned that, you know, that it was not Taliban, it was the Pakistan army that was fighting.
Yeah.
And I think it's no different right now after 17 years. It's the same thing that is happening in Afghanistan.
Absolutely. You know, it was so surprising because all the weapons other than the small arms were being manned by the Pakistanis, the crew served weapons like MMGs, etc. And the Pakistanis were using the forward observation officers for artillery. The guns were being used, and they were using their own air force. No, this was something, you know, which nobody has been able to, nobody has publicized.
Right.
To fight an army, a nation.
And a professional
and
army.
And a professional army. And he did that in a very, very magnificent fashion, and didn't give up. And you see, the point was there were so many options for him to get away and go away and then fight from outside.
He could have even gone to an exile.
Exile. Guess, but then, you know, he realized. I one day asked him, I said, why don't you go in an exile? And his thing was that when I go away, the people will think that I have abandoned them.
Right.
Well, that I thought was a magnificent thing for him to say.
Yeah.
In the end, what happened was, which was very, very, we had opened an hospital at in Tajikistan where we wanted to keep a facility where he could send his wounded people, and that's what it happened.
Right.
And then, you know, the I remember still that I was to retire in next about 10-15 days. I retired on 1st of October, and I was not very well, so I was in my bed, a sick bed. And I suddenly got the news that he has been assassinated.
Right.
And which was again done by people from who had infiltrated from Pakistan.
Right.
And I'm absolutely certain that there was a conspiracy, because the timing of the his assassination and the 9/11 attack on in New York was just about 10 days difference. they smuggled those two assassins in.
In fact, 2 days difference.
2 days difference.
2 days, yeah.
2 days difference. Mm. So they actually smuggled them in.
Right.
And those chaps pretended to be the correspondents.
Yes.
And in the end, they, when he was sitting in his room, which was a small room, I visited it later on.
Right.
They fired on him with a bazooka.
Yeah.
And also he had Khalili with him, who was a good friend, who ultimately became the ambassador, Afghan ambassador to Delhi. Mm-hmm. And he talks about the last meeting. He says one day before the meeting, mm-hmm. he was very sentimental about Afghanistan. He was sentimental about sentimental about the grief that he had that he couldn't achieve what he wanted to achieve.
Right.
And next day this happened. Mm-hmm. So in any case, what happened was that by the time, you see, his body was, he was recovered from the place,
right.
brought to the helicopter. Mm. And what an irony it is that the first patient who came to the facility
at Tajikistan,
which we had Tajikistan, mm. was his body.
My God.
So okay. it was actually a sense of a personal loss.
That's
when
right.
I heard about
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
But then subsequently after that I had retired, mm. and now I couldn't go anywhere. I was a civilian of sorts.
Yes.
And I went to Afghanistan.
Right.
I went to the area, I went and saw the places which were still being held by the Northern Alliance in a very precarious fashion.
Mm-hmm.
And it is then that General Amrullah, mm-hmm. who was his defense minister,
right.
he showed me his militia mm-hmm. Doing trainings. And it was gratifying to know that militia was very well disciplined. It was not a mob. Mm. It was not people you generally associate with the guerrillas. They actually were a real army. Mm. Actually an army which reminded one of the INA. It was a well-disciplined army and very well-led. And ultimately, I must tell you that when the Americans came in and the assault on Kabul started, mm. it was the Northern Alliance army which was in the forefront, mm. and the air support of course was given by the Americans.
Yes.
They also gave the artillery support, mm. but the boots on the ground, actually the ones who actually physically went there, were the people whom he had trained.
Yeah.
And that I think was a very big tribute to him.
Right.
And I wish the Americans had allowed the troops, these troops, to have done their tasks rather than halting them somewhere south of Kabul, which allowed these Pakistanis
mm.
you know, who were masquerading as Taliban fighters, mm. to disappear across the border,
right.
and continue to come again and again.
Right.
So I think in the end of the day, I think I must compliment you that you have picked up a commander, you have picked up a soldier, you have picked up a leader who was actually, in a way, one of the finest in this part of the world, in South Asia, I would say one of the finest. And I think it is high time that we studied more about him.
Right.
And we continue to regard him and continue to talk about him. Because once again, Afghanistan has gone into that same trap. Once again, you find the Taliban, which are stationed, supplied, equipped by the Pakistanis. Mm. And which once again are trying to be, the Pakistanis and their friends are trying to give them a face, give them respectability.
Yes.
Which ultimately can cost heavily, not only to Afghanistan, mm-hmm. it will,
mm.
but to the region and as well as to the globe.
To the globe, yes.
Somehow or the other, 17 years have passed,
yeah.
and we are still wanting to be bluffed into believing that the Afghans can be given a benign rule by the Taliban, the same chaps who destroyed what you call Afghanistan.
So I think that's a very important point that you make. But and therefore, Massoud's absence his importance also is underlined here. And I think that is why enemies of Afghanistan eliminated him 2 days before the attack in New York.
Absolutely. Mm. Because, you know, they felt that this man, supposing continues to survive and live, then he would be a formidable opponent, and they destroyed him.
Exactly.
So I think it is time, the biggest tribute to
Ahmed
Shah Massoud would be that we don't forget his legacy,
right.
and we don't get bluffed into believing that Taliban or ISIS mm-hmm. can be given respectability
in Afghanistan,
that we can allow them to, what do you call, once come
share
back,
power,
share or, power mm-hmm. or come and share, they will never, they will come back absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think that itself will be an aberration. And as his memory can only be sort of perpetuated in case we continue to support a fiercely independent and what do you call
self-reliant and prosperous
Afghanistan.
That's right. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks. Such a pleasure and such a important historical overview that you have given us. So that was Lieutenant General Sahani giving us an insight into what Ahmed Shah Massoud was all about and his inspiring leadership that led to the formation of Northern Alliance and of course later subsequently the troops which came into Kabul. But we know the history will be kinder to Ahmed Shah Massoud than what it has been, and therefore we thought at Strategic News International to recall this legendary guerrilla leader.